In the year 1241, Europe faced an invasion of Mongol cavalry. Protected by elaborate and heavy armor, the European knights were considered to be invincible. The Mongols, who generally wore relatively light and flexible armor, consisting of a multitude of overlapping leather or iron plates, would prove that speed and maneuverability were also important elements of a successful battle plan. European knights were trained to fight at close quarters. Their chief weapons were the heavy lance and the broadsword. The Mongols depended primarily on bows, and each carried 60 arrows of various weights for shooting from different distances. They rode ponies that were considerably smaller and faster than those of the European armies. As a result, the Mongols could strike their enemy with arrows from a safe distance. The European forces, with their heavy lances and broadswords, suffered heavy losses as the Mongol bowmen rained arrows down upon them with great precision. American military historian Trevor Dupuy says 60% of the Mongol army was light cavalry. Those riders handled reconnaissance and provided cover and assistance for the heavy cavalry. In a battle, the light cavalry was the main force, and their weapon of choice was the Mongol bow, a recurved composite bow. Normin is the vice chairman of the Mongol Archery Association of China. He makes traditional Mongol bows.
Mongol族小孩出生之前呢, 他父亲就给他做一把弓来，一旦到四五岁后就开始玩弓，啊，对这弓呢就是比较熟悉了。十七八岁这个蒙古小孩来说，那就是相当熟悉了。所以当时的蒙古人全民皆兵，人人会骑马射箭。This
Mongol bow is made of ox horn and a dozen other materials, and it takes 3 years to construct them. It's a powerful weapon in the hands of a skilled archer. Hai Rahun is a member of the Inner Mongolian Equestrian Team and has won great honors in domestic and international competitions. The range is one of the markers of a Mongol bow's power. A test of the range of these bows will be done using two common types of arrows. One will be a light arrow and the other a heavy arrow.
因为蒙古军队是无后方作战，它的这个有的时候补给需要取自于战场的狩猎，所以它要带各种各样的箭头。 如果是这个对手比较远的话呢，他用轻箭比较好；如果对手的用在近距离呢，他用重箭就可能射得更猛一些。It
is clear just how powerful an arrow is when shot by an experienced Mongol archer using a typical Mongol bow.
经过计算，轻舰的射程大概在180米左右，然后重舰的射程大概在134米左右。现在这个数据呢，轻舰这个数据还是比较符合历史。我们可以看到，这个重舰的，你像箭头这么大。
Different types of arrows have different ranges. The Mongol cavalry used these differences to its advantage on the battlefield.
那么当时的蒙古兵，他一般在下马步射的时候，他会用长弓，长弓呢搭配的比较长，但是箭头稍微轻一点的箭。那么如果说他是在马上这个跟对方骑射，那么他需要的是用短弓。这个时候呢，用的这个箭的箭杆比较短，为了杀伤力大呢，他就箭头可以做的比较重，因为他只是在50米左右才会发箭。
Armed with different kinds of bows and arrows, and using aggressive tactics, the Mongols conquered place after place. Finally, they faced the European knights, who were nicknamed Metal Fortresses. A test of the Mongols' two types of arrows will show how they performed against the armor of the European knights. Pork meat will substitute for the human body, and it will be protected with European armor. Hai Rahun is going to shoot 4 heavy arrows and 4 light arrows at the target.
，深度上有差别，深度那个都在8左右，都在8左右，对，这个这轻舰呢都不到5，四点四点五，两者的损伤来讲肯定是这个重舰要好很多，
那个重舰伤口都长，是吧？伤口大，
对，
是吧？这几个都挺大，但是轻舰呢，这个伤口都小，都细。
西方的记载说，这个蒙古用这个重箭破甲呀，这可能还是对的，
有根据。
对，所以教练这个对这个人的这个战斗力影响来说呀，重箭还是明显大，
挺明显的。
对，而且当时中国人其实也记过，但中国人不是针对蒙古箭，中国人也是提到是这个大型箭头打在身上叫重者利弊嘛，就是打上之后人马上就死了。
Against the Mongol cavalry, European knights found themselves powerless to organize any defense or assault. The Mongols could shoot arrows with great accuracy while riding at a fast pace, even turning while astride their ponies to shoot accurately at a pursuer. The European divisions were vanquished one by one. While their commanders tried desperately to organize defense and counterattacks with their crossbow archers,
They realized the Mongols, who wore very simple armor, seemed unscathed by their counter-assaults. There was a myth that Mongol cavalry riders wore magical silk armor that protected them from being hurt by arrows or bolts. This is a replica of a silk robe from that period. And this is a crossbow made using the technology of that period as well. It will be seen whether this thin layer of silk can protect a person from European arrows. John of Pien de Carpine, one of the first Europeans to enter the court of the great Khan of the Mongol Empire, wrote that most of the Mongol light cavalry wore only a layer of leather armor with silk lining instead of full body armor. To determine whether silk was protection against arrows, two targets are set up. One is covered by leather armor with cotton lining, and the other has leather armor with silk lining. A European crossbow will be positioned 20 meters away. The test demonstrated that the leather and the cotton are not sufficient to protect the cavalry against an arrow. But will silk be any better? Although it seems unlikely, but the test will answer that question.
从这个损伤程度来说，跟上次差别并不是那么十分明显，但是就发现它是确实是带进一部分，也是有一定的作用。但是对于这个强大的这动能的箭足来说，这锁子甲都能穿透，它还是应该是微不足道的这些阻力。
The protection offered by silk seems to be highly exaggerated. But if the silk robe is ineffective, why would the Mongols use such expensive fabric?
它真正防御箭主要是靠牛皮甲和铁叶甲，但是一旦箭头，比方说穿过了两层甲，还是插在了部分进入的这个身体的话呢，有生丝或者生绢这种比较柔韧的东西呢，在后期救治的时候，那么可以用这个东西的包裹把这个箭头拉出来，否则在当时的医疗条件下就有可能化脓啊、感染呢、啊，箭头是不能留在身体里的，那么实际上它只是一件衣服而已。
In a hail of Mongol arrows, the European knights collapsed one after the other. At this point, the Mongol heavy cavalry appeared to finish the battle. The strategy for the Mongol army was simple. It was usually deployed in five rows. The first two rows were heavy cavalry, and the second three rows were light cavalry. When approaching close to the enemy, the light cavalry moved into the lead and began to initiate long-range attacks. When the enemy's battle formations were broken by a hail of Mongol arrows, the heavy cavalry would move forward to deliver a fatal blow.
他没有医疗条件，而且他的人员数量也比农耕的少，在这种情况下，实际上他打的是非接触战。那么相对于这个当时刀矛的这种攻击距离来说呢，骑兵他要把自己控制在25米之外、50米以内，他可以在马上用骑射的方法逐渐的消耗对手，直到他觉得对手已经打垮了，他才会投入重骑兵进行接触战。换句话说，才会有冷兵器的这个直接的撞击。
The early Mongol armies used keet and sabers. Later, they adopted the Turco saber, which they obtained by trading with merchants from the Middle East. Eventually, they combined the two and developed their own design, the Turco-Mongol saber. With the adoption of technology from China, they could forge high-quality Mongol sabers. Martial artist Zhang Yugang learned how to use a saber when he was young. Now he'll demonstrate how the Mongol saber works. The saber was very destructive. The European knights, however, were the most heavily armored warriors in the world. They wore chainmail or plate armor, and the elite among them wore full body armor. It would seem impossible for the Mongol saber to render the seemingly unconquerable metal fortress defenseless.
This one. 没有砍透这个胸甲，只是在这胸甲上留下一个长条形的一个凹陷，整个这个凹陷的深度也就1.5公分，也就是熬进去了，这个对这个皮肤啊没有造成任何的损伤。
那在这个历史上呢，我们说这个弯刀这些类的武器，实际上是确实是对这个板甲没有什么有效杀伤力。
The test suggests the Mongol saber wasn't effective against European armor. Perhaps the Mongol heavy cavalries had more effective weapons in their arsenals. Historic accounts say the Mongols carried various short-handled weapons, such as an axe, the wolf fang staff, and others. They were allowed to choose weapons according to their own preference. The most popular weapon among them was a hammer, which the Mongols called gudor. A gudor is basically a hammer with a long handle and a metal head shaped like a clove of garlic. It's said the gudor was good at piercing armor. Cheng Zhejian is a Baji boxer. He's also good at using a staff. He'll try his hand at swinging a gudor. The first step of the test is to set the target. The Mongol cavalry formations seemed rather loose, and their weapons seemed simple, but their strategy and training proved effective. 100,000 European knights were annihilated. The Mongol conquest of Europe was achieved through a combination of clever strategy and tactics, a well-trained cavalry, enhanced weapons, and ponies known for speed and endurance. The artillery camp of the Ming Dynasty in China was the world's first heavy armaments division. In the next episode, we'll discover the accuracy, range, and destructive power of those early artillery guns. Please join us for part 5 of Weapons of Ancient China.